We now welcome in head trainer and spokesperson for CrossFit, Russell Berger. We also welcome Mark Ripito, a strength coach and author of several books, including Starting Strength, Basic Barbell Training. Mark was once affiliated with CrossFit. Russell, we'll start with you. What was your reaction after hearing that piece?
Well, first, I'd like to thank you for having me on the show. What I could hear from the piece sounded very typical, very consistent with what we have been hearing in media about CrossFit in general in the last few weeks. And I think you have probably become aware that CrossFit is getting more and more attention. And I think one of the guests that you, or one of the people you interviewed for that segment said it very well. It's just jealousy. There are so many organizations in the traditional fitness industry that feel threatened by what CrossFit has been doing in terms of both its rapid growth and success, that there is a growing feeling that they need to target CrossFit and try and paint it as something dangerous and scary to try and prevent us from growing any further, to try and carve out some segment of the fitness industry that we're not basically taking over.
Mark, why did you part ways with CrossFit?
Well, that happened back in 2009. I had some disagreements about the way CrossFit was being programmed, and I sensed a divergence between my thinking and that of the people responsible for the programming that CrossFit is known for.
And, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by the programming?
Well, the random nature of it. First, training is a process by which athletic ability is obtained. It's the process by which adaptation is obtained. And it's the simple stress recovery adaptation model that's prevalent through biology. Training is a process that utilizes this in a logical, programmed way. And the random nature of CrossFit main site programming is not really training, it's exercise. The problem, as I perceive it, with CrossFit is that in CrossFit boxes, competition is encouraged. After all, CrossFit bills itself as the sport of fitness. Training, in the conventional sense, strength training, has a very, very low injury rate. And I'm not aware of the injury rate in CrossFit, but I am aware of the fact that competitive sports all have higher injury rates than traditional strength training because of the competitive nature and the desire to push for PRs or a win. If CrossFit presents itself as a sport of fitness, it's not unusual to observe people who have not gone through the process of training push themselves to a point where injuries could occur. And it's just a logical extension of the fact that CrossFit builds itself and promotes itself as a competitive sport.
One of the concerns that were raised by a current CrossFit trainer in the piece is that with the proliferation of these boxes across the country, it's not possible to have them all teach the snatch and the clean and jerk in a safe manner. Russell, how would you respond to that?
I'd actually like to respond to something that Mark has said. And just by way of background, I've actually had the privilege of being able to train under Mark in the past, and I have an immense amount of respect for his coaching abilities. But I think he's dead wrong on a number of points. First is the distinction between training and exercise, which in Mark's words is based on this idea that training is something that has a specified amount of planning and a distinct goal, whereas exercise is yeah. Sort of just spontaneous human activity. And the problem I have with that is that CrossFit does have a distinct goal, and CrossFit's methodology, which uses constant variance, is not random. And in order to constantly vary your programming, you have to specifically and intentionally plan it ahead of time in order to get the broadest possible stimulus in training. So Mark is basically he's fundamentally misrepresenting what CrossFit is teaching. And second, Mark's co-author on his book, Starting Strength, who's, I think, respected by both of us as well as everyone in the fitness industry, Dr. Lon Kilgore, has recently said in an interview with CrossFit that he thinks Mark's distinction between training and exercise is just a semantic game. It's not anything that has any real meaning. And I think it's something that Mark is doing specifically to allow him to be able to critique CrossFit by putting up this straw man version of the program that doesn't exist. CrossFit is not random. It may appear random to those that don't understand what constant variance is, but it's by no means random. And I can say that having taught that very point at seminars almost every weekend since 2009.
Well, Mark, let's go back to you real quick. You were a part of the CrossFit community. Now you're not. So why was it okay then and not now?
Well, Russell may be under the impression that I don't understand the difference between random and training. Russell's mistaken. I'm quite aware of the distinction between
these two. That's not what I said. I said you don't seem to understand what CrossFit teaches.
Well, Russell, I do, in fact, understand it quite well. And I disagree with
it. Let's not get out of into the semantics.
It is not
like, I'm just curious, Mark, why before being a part of CrossFit was okay, and then you separated, and now it's not?
Because I think CrossFit changed.
How so?
I think CrossFit changed fundamentally. And Russell, of course, will disagree with this, but I saw a deterioration in the quality of both the programming and the attempts to educate people on how to execute it. We can go back and forth on the crazy nature of some of the CrossFit workouts, which are in fact random. And I mean, if you expose a person to a clean and jerk once every 6 weeks, it's not possible to obtain proficiency. Now, we deal with CrossFit affiliates all over the country.
Could you define random for me, Mark? What do you mean when you say the CrossFit workouts are random?
Not repeating skill-based exercises on a regular enough basis to allow a progressive
adaptation
to take place.
Not only is that inaccurate, because CrossFit does repeat skill-based exercises on a regular basis, but that's a false dichotomy. It's a false
dilemma. How often in the last 6 weeks?
You're saying that it's either random or it's periodized.
Well, Russell, how often in the last 6 weeks has a main site workout repeated the clean and jerk?
That's a good question. And if it didn't repeat it at all, that doesn't mean main site programming is random.
It is a good question, isn't it? It is a good question.
Here's another question for Russell, because I want to get into the idea of the two-day course to become a level one certified trainer. How much hands-on experience for coaching does the level one training course provide?
That's a good question. The level one training course currently provides over 300 minutes of practical instruction, hands-on instruction in some foundational functional movements that the CrossFit methodology is built upon. Now, any claim or any criticism of the CrossFit level one needs to be put in context. CrossFit did not invent or create an experienced trainer. And without CrossFit, a trainer could easily go out and open any gym they wanted to and use the same methodology. It's not something that we've started. CrossFit has created an educational program through our level one certification and our level one certificate course and our other certifications that we offer that is the best source of instruction on functional movements in the fitness industry. So anyone who says your CrossFit level one isn't enough, it's not enough to be able to train other people as a personal trainer, needs to put that in the context by comparing it to all the other industry certifications and seminars that are available. And I don't know of a single seminar in the fitness industry that has any hands-on training in foundational functional movements.
Russell,
CrossFit is the only one that does that.
Would you say, Russell, is room for improvement, in that training area?
Yeah, CrossFit has always been open to the the level one is never something we've suggested is the end-all and be-all of your training. And when I teach the level ones, one of the messages that we try and make clear to the participants is that this is a first step in training.
We do have to end it there. Good conversation. Russell Berger, Mark Rippetoe, we appreciate the time from both of you today on Outside the Lines.